Welcome back to New Hampshire, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Josh. It's great to be back.
So let's get right to it. So this week, taking a lot of criticism about some recent comments made about the VA, saying the scandal was overblown and that the problems aren't as widespread as people would have you believe. Do you stand by these comments?
You know, I share the outrage that everybody felt when the scandal was finally discovered and people began to address it. There were clearly systemic problems, and those problems must be dealt with. I've already been talking about what I would do. But I am worried about some people trying to use the fact that we need to make major reforms as a justification for dismantling the VA. And I think my comments were really more directed at that. I want us to fix what's wrong. I want us to make sure that anyone who's ever served our country, no matter what age, no matter when they served, gets whatever medical support that they need. And I support the program that was passed to provide the opportunity, if you can't get the services you need in your VA, to be able to go out and get those services in the community. But from all of my work on behalf of veterans, there's a lot about the VA that's right, a lot that works. And so let's focus on what's wrong and fix it, and not let anybody use that as an excuse, because there are things that have to be fixed to try to dismantle the VA.
You don't think it needs a complete overhaul like some have called for?
Well, I think it needs a top-to-bottom review, but what works should be continued, and what doesn't work needs to be stopped and fixed. And, you know, some of the VA services have very high marks, and some are way behind the times. And what I want is a top-to-bottom review, and then, you know, having people, like a SWAT team almost, going in and fixing what needs to be fixed so that no veteran ever has to worry about, is the quality of care good? Am I going to get in the door? Is somebody playing games with the numbers? You know, that stuff is just inexcusable and wrong. But we do know that a lot of great medical care is provided by the VA. So I don't want to throw the old saying, the baby out with the bath. I want to, you know, drain the bath of all the bad stuff that's in there, and then I want to make sure that it's working for all of our veterans.
Earlier this week, you implied that your primary opponent, Bernie Sanders, is a sexist, or at the very least his comments were sexist. Do you believe that he's attacking you based solely on your gender?
Well, what I said was during the debate, when I heard him say that people should stop shouting about guns, I didn't think I was shouting. I thought I was making a very strong case as to why we all need to come together to do something about the out of control gun violence in America. 90 people a day being killed by guns, either by their own hand or homicide or an accident, 33,000 a year. Families coming up to me and telling me stories that I just heard here at the college. A man said, my family was a victim of gun violence, you know, and told me about a member of his family killed by domestic violence. So I think it's a serious problem, and I'm not going to be silenced. I don't think anybody who has thought about this problem should be.
But as far as the implication that Bernie Sanders is a sexist, you wouldn't go that far.
I said what I had to say about it. I think that we have a different record on guns. We have a different approach on guns. I think that's a fair issue to talk about, and I'm going to keep talking about it.
Sure. So let's talk about the guns. You have talked a lot about it. You've had kind of an evolving opinion when it comes to the idea of a national registry, perhaps fingerprint licensing. Where do you stand on it now?
You know, what I want to do is tackle the problems that we know we can solve. Number one, a truly universal background check that is up to date and is technologically as advanced as we can make it. Closing the loopholes, particularly the gun show loophole, doing more to prevent the online sales of guns and, you know, ammunition to people we have no idea who's on the other end of the order. Closing what's called the Charleston loophole, so that under the law as it currently stands, a gun seller only has to wait 3 business days before he can sell the gun. And unfortunately, the shooter in Charleston should have never been able to buy a gun, because it didn't turn up until it was too late that he had a felony conviction. So we need to close that loophole. And we've got to reverse the liability protection, the unique liability protection that only the gun industry gets in America. Nobody else does. And I voted against that when I was a senator, and I think it's bad to give any industry in America a total blanket check to do exactly what they choose to do and not to be held accountable.
You wrapped up the congressional hearings this week. Do you consider Benghazi a settled issue now?
You know, I went because I did feel, you know, very strongly that anything we can do together to try to keep our civilians abroad safer, we need to do. You know, the army and our military has after action reviews, and I think that we should always do that. That's why I was the one who said, let's have an accountability review. That's what I was interested in, and I hope that the Congress will now take more action and pass some of the bills and make some of the decisions that will provide better training for our diplomatic security personnel and make sure that they have everything they need in a dangerous world.
Finally, the last time we spoke, we were talking about the opioid crisis and the heroin problem here in New Hampshire. You said that this is a major priority in your campaign and would be for your administration. And you said that the federal government should examine going across borders if need be to stamp out these fields. I get that you're running for president, but in your opinion, what should individual states like New Hampshire do on their own to try and stop the pipeline?
Well, I know that the governor, Governor Hassan, has come out with a plan, and I think that there does have to be a coordinated effort with law enforcement to try to stem the supply. But I think most states, the vast majority of states, can't do very much on their own. They're going to need federal support to that end. But there's a lot in what the governor rolled out, I think, today that I think is very promising in terms of what New Hampshire itself can do to deal with this crisis.
And in terms of New Hampshire, how much time you plan on spending here, and how important is it, do you think? I mean, the poll numbers have been bouncing around quite a bit, but how important do you think it is to have a solid victory in New Hampshire?
Well, I'm going to work as hard as I can here in the state. I love New Hampshire. New Hampshire has been good to my husband and me, and I love coming here. I have friends that I first made 23 years ago, and I'm really looking forward to spending as much time as I can here, and I'm not taking anything for granted. I'm going to work hard to earn every vote I can.
Well, thank you very much for your time today.
Good to talk to you, Josh,
good
always.
To see you as
Thanks.
Well.